Hello. Ooh, that sound good, y'all. Ooh. Everybody look at each other and say hello. Say, I'm glad to see you. Say, you look good tonight. Oh, come on, let's praise the Lord. It's a wonderful opportunity to be here. And we just want to say thank you for coming on tonight. You are going to be blessed. Do you believe that? All right, I want you to receive that. If you believe that, receive that. You are going to be blessed. Just say it for yourself. I am going to be blessed. So that means that you got to have a great attitude. You got to receive tonight. You got to begin to clap for somebody else. You got to begin to celebrate what God has brought somebody else through. Oh, you got to know that you are the one that was chosen to be able to say that I am going to make it through this. Whew, I see some beautiful faces on tonight. So I just want to celebrate this woman of God right here. My name is Lady Lily, and I am with
Fever Daniels.
Yes.
How y'all doing today? You guys look absolutely amazing. It is such an honor to be here on today. Aren't you guys excited?
Yes.
Let me hear you guys give it up. Yes, give it up.
All right. Well, I am here to introduce the founder of this beautiful experience. It's an experience, y'all. Whew. And as she was birthing this thing, I was the midwife trying to help her get it through. Sarah Mae Brown, wife of CEO and Arthur Delancey Brown. Together, the entrepreneurs have two successful companies, Intrepid Transport Trucking and Intrepid Credit Consultants, where they have blessed many with the knowledge of credit and wealth. Woo-hoo. They go together, y'all.
Come on now.
Credit and wealth.
All right.
Ooh, she received that. She said credit and wealth. All right. The definition of intrepid means fearless and bold moves in what they do. Sarah is the mother of three beautiful children, Trinity, Charlia, and Kayvon. Sarah has a huge heart and operates with passion to serve others. In the pursuit to serve in the highest of the greatest, Sarah attended and graduated from the elite Van School of Prophets, taught by the world-renowned pastor and author, Joshua Giles, of Joshua Giles Ministries. There she both sculptured and learned skills and language that would catapult her to her next level of anointing. Sarah founded Destiny Over Diagnosis. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand. Woo! After her vigorous fight with epilepsy for nearly two decades. How many decades? How many years is that? 20 years. Sarah was 17 years old and pregnant with her first child. She had her first of many seizures. By the age of 19, was faced with diagnosis of epilepsy. She decided to stop focusing on the don'ts that came with the diagnosis and concentrate on the do's. Sarah personally understands how intimidating it feels to begin a diagnosis of a life of altering ailments. Now, she's talking to people who have been given a concrete ceiling, causing them to see as glass and break through it. Not only are they choosing to push themselves, but they are shattering the stigma placed on the diagnosis and showing others that there is a life after diagnosis. There is destiny over the diagnosis presented today. She continues to lead by example. Oh, yes, she does. She started a spiritual wellness journey after battling in a hopeless place. She did the work on the inside to restore hope and activate her faith. Woo! Once she became spiritually well, she worked hard to cultivate a plan. They will become spiritually well along the way. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you my spiritual daughter, Sarah Mae Brown.
Doing. Yeah, I know it's real elegant in here because the Lord told me to turn it up a notch. So it's real elegant, but y'all know I got it in me. I got it out the mud, y'all. I walked to school, I ain't had no bus. I want to pray, and if you guys will worship with me for about a couple minutes, because we want to give the Lord some space. Okay. Thank you, Jesus. If you can stand to your feet if you're able. Because this event was already done in heaven. Your award was already given out in heaven. And the word teaches us as it is in heaven, so it is on earth. Victory was already won in heaven. So let's win this thing on earth. I want to talk to the people that only had enough strength to raise your hand so high. Just a little bit. And you waited on the Father to come and quit. I don't know if you ever been there. Where that was the only option. Just waiting on the Father to grab your hand. Thank you, Jesus. If you could just worship with me. My husband is the DJ. We got a beautiful orchestra. You guys look wonderful tonight. I'll take my worship song. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we welcome you in this place, Jesus. Fall fresh upon us, oh God. Fresh wind from heaven. Fall fresh, fall fresh. One thing I do know, that we are all living testimonies of his glory manifested here in the earth. He trusted us. He trusted us with his soul. The word said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Is there anybody redeemed? Is there anybody redeemed in this place? Has anybody been redeemed out of the hands of the enemy? Has anybody had to wake up and step on the devil's neck? Anybody been redeemed from taking 25 pills a day? Not even being able to know where you're at and what you're doing? Anybody been redeemed? I want to talk to the redeemed people. I need to talk to the redeemed people. I want to talk to the people that has been through something, a hopeless situation. I want to talk to the people that had gave a ceiling to them, concrete ceiling. And we said, I'ma bust through this thing anyhow. I'ma bust through it anyhow. Lord, when my back against the wall and I don't know who to talk to and I don't know who to trust and I don't know where to go and the pills make me feel bad and my body is wrecked with pain, all I have is your promise. All I have is your word. All I have is your promise. All I have is your word. And this enough. This enough is enough. I was 17 years old when the doctor told me that I had epilepsy. And all my friends was going off to college. And I couldn't understand why the Lord would give me such a diagnosis after such a hard life. And I couldn't understand why they got to go room with their buddies and I had to take 17 pills. I couldn't understand why I had to have a nurse 24 hours a day, and I'm only 18 years old. I couldn't understand that. I didn't get that. So my first thought, I was getting up out of here. I was ready to commit suicide. That was my first thought. And I took as much pills as I can get in my mouth, and I swallowed them. And I waited. And I waited. And I waited. And I felt like my escape was not going to happen for me. I waited. I waited. God, come get me. I don't want to do this. I'm having 10 seizures a day. I can't function. I can't talk. Missouri took my license. I can't do much. Come get me. I don't want to wait on no rapture. Come get me. I end up having the worst stomachache of my life. Somebody say, she had a destiny. Hallelujah. All right. So let's go ahead. I want you guys to know a little bit about Destiny Over Diagnosis and what we've done. This is our second award ceremony, and we plan to do this annually. Amen. Amen. If the Lord say the same, we're this all volunteer work, 501c3, nonprofit. We ain't making no money. We just making an impact. Yeah. Amen. Amen. So I just want y'all to see this and, just say thank you to somebody. So many volunteers, so many hands went into this, and I wanted to show y'all what they decided to say yes to and what y'all said yes to today.
I don't know if you know this, but there's a choice to be made. Webster says the definition of diagnosis is an act identifying a disease from its signs and symptoms. Destiny is a predetermined course of events often held to be irresistible power. Which decision will you make? Would you choose your destiny over your diagnosis? I know I did.
Destiny Over Diagnosis is a community where people gather to abandon their doctor's diagnosis and focus on their God-given destiny. Destiny Over Diagnosis is an organization of hope for those struggling with life after being diagnosed with a life-altering ailment. Our organization is based on five pillars of sowing the seams to success. These seams are sown through service, education, awareness, ministry, and support. We want to make a difference through service, by community outreach and charitable events, through education, from hosting workshops, facilitating learning environments, and providing expert leadership, awareness, participating in walks and events, along with donating to like-minded organizations.
And she don't know, what about some gift cards or something? We want to give away something every week until Christmas.
Destiny Over Diagnosis' future goals include becoming a resource hub, giving away $10,000 in scholarships annually to assist with educational needs, becoming a nationwide organization, raising awareness to various diagnoses.
Waiting for, it's time to rise. What are you waiting for? It's time to get up.
What are you waiting for? It's time to go forth. Possess the land, possess the land, possess the land. Possess the land, possess the land, possess the land. Possess the land, possess the land, possess the land.
I want to give the first award really quick because I want to respect this beautiful woman's time and her dedication to the mission that we put together, and she heard it, and she like, I'm with it, I like that. Like, she didn't have, she could have legit thought we was crazy or a stalker like much, but she didn't, and I want to respect her time because she came up it's her baby's 16th, sweet 16, right? Yeah. And despite that, she said, I got to tell my story. She's doing God's work. God going to do hers. So they're going to read your bio right quick, Keisha. And then I think they got a video for you. And then you'll get your award. Amen. Hallelujah.
All right, Keisha Lee, dedication to securing essential resources for Annie Malone, has been recognized and honored. Her partnership with Procter & Gamble has resulted in quarterly deliveries. Has resulted in quarterly deliveries of vital supplies, supplying the agency sufficient cost. Her commitment to the community and exceptional leadership have not gone unnoticed, as she has received numerous prestigious awards, including the Minority Woman Business Leader Awards, Get It Your Strength Back Girl Awards, Omega Psi Phi Citizen of the Year Awards, and now Destiny Over Diagnosis Awards. Through her remarkable efforts, Keisha Lee has successfully secured substantial funding for Annie Malone. Her tenacity has resulted in state funding and an expansion of services through the County Services Fund grant. Furthermore, Annie Malone's reputation as a community or an engaged organization has flourished under Keisha's leadership, exemplified by successful hosting and of connecting communities, thriving families in St. Louis in community engagement, conveying at the city's agency. In pursuit of excellence, Keisha Lee has worked diligently to secure a prestigious COA accreditation for Annie Malone, ensuring agency's adherence to high standards and commitment to quarterly service until 2026. Additionally, she has organized numerous volunteer days, saving the agency's significant expenses in renovating and labor projects. Also, fostering a sense of community and engagement. Also, while fostering a sense of community and engagement. Outside of Annie Malone, Keisha Lee has a notable impact Outside of Annie Malone, Keisha Lee has made a notable impact as a community leader. Her involvement as a board member of Missouri Coalition for Children, RBC Leadership 100, chair of St. Louis County NAACP, and Focus St. Louis CORO Woman in Leadership reflects her deep commitment to driving positive change in various spheres. Keisha Lee has a transformative leadership and unwavering dedication, having undeniably left an incredible mark on Annie Malone and the St. Louis community at large. The CEO of Annie Malone, Keisha Lee, is widely regarded in the community as an incredibly approachable and genuinely kind residents and employee alike praise her warm demeanor and willingness to engage with everyone on a personal level. Despite her high-profile position, Keisha Lee remains down-to-earth and approachable, making herself accessible to all the members of the community, whether during a company meeting, community events, or chance encounters. She actively listens to people's concerns and ideas, fostering atmospheres for openness and inclusion. Her admirable nature and enthusiastic attitude have earned her a deep respect and admiration from those who have had the opportunity to interact with her, in reinforcing her reputation as an exceptional leader and true people person-centered CEO. We all face challenges, but would you describe, I think this is a question for you, we all face challenges, but would you describe it as a relatively smooth road? I believe this is what you said. It doesn't make it clear, but no, it is not a smooth road, but it's a road worth taking. Struggles to rebrand Annie Malone and personal battle with breast cancer. I introduce you guys to Miss Keisha Lee.
She's just a girl and she's on fire. Hotter than a fantasy. Lonely like a highway. She's living in a world and it's on fire. Filled with catastrophe, but she knows she can fly away. Oh, she got both feet on the ground and she's burning it down. Oh, she got her head in the clouds and she's not backing down. This girl is on fire.
I almost said, who are you talking about? That's a lot of stuff. Thank you, Miss Sarah, for having me. Today's my daughter's sweet 16. And when I saw her message, I was actually at treatment when I got her message. And my daughter was next to me, and I was reading it, and I called you. And I said, I'm sorry I can't come because that's my daughter's sweet 16. And I got off the phone with you, and my daughter was sitting there, and she said, what's the name of it? And I said, Destiny Over Diagnosis. She was like, Ma, you should go. That sounds like you. And I had to call you back, like, okay, I'm going to come, and I'm going to come, and I'm going to go, you know, stuff like that. But this is the one. You know, you read off all the other ones, but this one means something. So it's important for me to be here. And it's important because I didn't think that I would be here today. I didn't think I would make it to July 22nd, 2023 when I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And I've had 8 surgeries, the last 2 this year alone. So my grandma always said, never look like what you're going through, right? Yeah. And, you know, the doctors have the diagnosis, but God has the prognosis. And I had a relationship with God way before all this, so trusting him wasn't nothing I ever questioned. I was just afraid to leave my baby and my family, but it's Annie Malone and my family kept me. I was diagnosed in 2019 at the end of December, December the 8th, and I went through my first surgery in 2020, February 13th. Before my anniversary, and I've been through 8 since then. So I went through everything alone during the pandemic. So being in a hospital full of people and none of them your family, that's scary. But when you in that hospital and you laying there by yourself, it ain't nobody but you and God. That's it. It's you and God. And I think that strength allowed me to pour more strength into my babies at Annie Malone and my family at home. Because every time I came out of a surgery, when it was time to come home, they all was there waiting on me at my house. You know, so that meant a lot. But destiny over diagnosis, for sure. I was already feisty, but I didn't know I had this much strength in me. Really, I didn't. So everything else you read, the destiny of a diagnosis, just know that means something to me. Yes. That's why it was important for me to be here. And praising God is second nature. Every time I get up, I know the devil like, dang, she up again. Yeah, I'm her. I'm her. I'm up again. So this is an honor. And it was a journey. I mean, through 8 surgeries, and I'm gonna be real with you. It was a point where I have to relearn to love myself the way I look. When I went to my mother, my hair fell out and I cried, and my mother was like, "You already had your hair short before, baby. What's wrong?" I said, "This time it wasn't my choice, mama. That hurt." My husband of 17 years, to this day, I'm gonna be honest with you, I still can't take my shirt off in front of him. I have to relearn to love myself. So leaning on God, but also leaning on mental health and therapy and everything else, I had to do that. I had to do that. And it's still those days. I still question stuff, and I still do it, and I still get scared. I still get scared. That's why it was important for me to be here today and understand everybody's like, you need to sit down. And when God want me to sit down, he make me sit down. He make me sit down. But as long as I got some strength in me, I'm up and I'm not in that bed laying down. Not at all. Not at all. So having my destiny trump my diagnosis feels really good. Really good. Real good. So I just thank you. Thank all of you guys. Thank you, Miss Sarah, for just what you're doing, having that voice and being able to give awards like this. This, I'm telling you, all the other stuff y'all read, this means something. So it was important that I be here today. And listen, I love you, what you're doing, and I'm going to keep fighting as long as y'all keep fighting with me. It's important when you got that strength in you, because what I do is not easy. But when God is in me, it's hard to tell a kid that's already broken and don't have anybody in their life, and you looking at these kids and you like, who don't want you? You got to have something in you to able to pour into them. That's a different beast when you looking at a 3-year-old with tears in their eyes and don't nobody want them, or they hungry, or they learning to re-love themselves. Yeah. It's different, and I'm going to tell you something else. It ain't just the other color, it's us too. I done got kids that look like us that's been kept in a cage and fed feces and urine. You know how hard it is to break that from a child? And they come and they eat all the food, and you're like, baby, you can have whatever you want. You don't have to steal the food. Then they come to a point where they starting to go back to what they learned and eat feces. You got to try to break that. Nah, I don't want to go there today. I'm going to go here today because this is where my heart is. This is where I want to be today. And that's the part of taking care of me. Thank you.
All right, y'all. We really want to go ahead and show y'all what Destiny Over Diagnosis is about, but I wanted to honor Keisha's time because her baby is 16, y'all. That's so sweet. Like, for real. So for her to squeeze us in and drop those nuggets, everybody say, God bless you, Keisha. Yes. And she ain't even sneezing.
Okay, everybody, I'm back. Hope y'all enjoying yourselves so far. Good. Well, good evening, everyone. I'm honored to be here tonight to celebrate the strength and determination of these amazing people. When you're first diagnosed with a serious illness, it can be easy. It can feel easy to give up on life, and it can feel like everything is over. I know personally, because I was a recipient of the Destiny Over Diagnosis Reward last year. I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in 2012. I have been paralyzed, I've been crippled, I've been blind 5 times, I've even been deaf in 1 ear. But God. When you're diagnosed with a lifelong illness, you may feel like you have no control over your destiny. But these individuals we're going to introduce to you today have shown that that's not the case. They too have refused to let their diagnosis define them. They have chosen to fight back and live their lives to the absolute fullest. I know it hasn't been easy. There have been times where you were scared, when you wanted to give up, but you kept going. You've pushed past the pain and fear and ran towards your destiny. These individuals are an inspiration to us all. They show us that anything is possible when you set your mind to it. They've shown us that we can overcome any obstacle that we're faced with. No matter how daunting it may seem, you are living proof that, that you have the power to overcome any obstacle that comes your way. You guys are the embodiment of the phrase, destiny is not a matter of chance, but a matter of choice. You have chosen to live your lives to the fullest. You have chosen to make a difference in the world. You are an inspiration to us all. We are grateful that you have I am so grateful that you are here today and that you have shown the courage and the determination that you guys have. Thank you. I would like to share these quotes with you guys. Helen Keller says, "The only thing worse than a blind person is a person that has no vision, sight but no vision." And lastly, Nelson Mandela says, "It always seems impossible until it's done." These individuals have shown that they have vision and that they know how to get things done. I'm so inspired by them, and I know you will be too. Thank you guys for being here tonight and having me. This next recipient is Omarion Griffin. Omarion was born in St. Louis, Missouri. He recently graduated from Cardinal Ritter College Prep High School and maintained a 3.8, 3.9 GPA all the way through. In 2023, he was awarded the Living Legend Award, National Honor Society, Athletic Scholar Award, Archbishop May Community Service Award, Edward Jones Scholar Award, and North County Commerce Resilience Award. Woohoo! I mean, awarded out. Also, on May 19th, he was crowned National Mr. June 19th Pageant Award. He is the youngest of his parents' children. He volunteers at homeless shelters, the Ronald McDonald House, Perpetual Health Development Center, and St. Vincent. In his free time, he enjoys reading, cooking, dancing, making TikToks, video games, basketball, running track, and soccer. He has beat the odds. In 2019, Omarion was diagnosed with a rare autoimmune disease that caused his immune system to attack his own body. He is also diagnosed with SVT, autonomic disease, hypertension, and some type of syndrome. I don't know the name of it, but my God. He spent weeks and even months in and out of the hospital for years. When a couple of doctors suggest his family to put him in a home or on hospice, Omarion put his faith in God and never looked back. Omarion's favorite quote is, "God is my today and my tomorrow." Come on now. Omarion has been accepted into 70 colleges, plus received $3.5 million in scholarships for academics. He will be attending Mid-America of Nazarene University when he received an offer to play basketball while pursuing his bachelor's degree in exercise science and wants to become a physical therapist. His goal is to open up a gym for kids 5 through 17 with the study area quiet zone so that students may study before and after practice. Food court, pediatrician, social. Well, that was it. Well, anyway, all of that, This young guy is exceptional, and I cannot wait to meet him. Let's bring up Amorion Griffin for the next Destiny Over Diagnosis Awards.
Without him, I wouldn't even be here, so thank you, Jesus. Like she said, my name is Amorion Griffin. I'm 18. You know, I experienced a lot in my teenage years that most teenagers haven't experienced. So I just like to look at it as being very wise at this young age. I just take a lot of knowledge that my family has taught me and just put it in a positive environment. See, like 2019 is where it all started. It was in January. I woke up with a drastic headache. I just try to, you know, play it off because I wasn't thinking much of it, you know. I'm like, it's just a little headache. I'm in school. I love going to school. So I was not trying to go home. I was like, no, I don't have to go home. It's just a little headache. It wore off. And when I got home, it just kept getting worse. I was not getting out the bed for the next 2 days. My mom just was like constantly checking up on me until she was like, no, something got changed. We got to go to the hospital. First go around, we went to the hospital. Doctors was very just like, he's probably making up, you know, he just got a headache, he don't want to go to school, when that wasn't the case. So that we just constantly kept going back until somebody just put a finger on it, at least a finger, and, you know, and it was hard seeing my mom cry and break down because, you know, as a mother, she always try to fix it, you know. A mother is a fixer, you know, and it was hard for me, too. I'm like, that's my mom. Like, you know, you got to fix it. Like, what you doing? I'm like, my heart's taking longer than usual. Even though my dad would be up there, you know, my dad come up, he just said, like, hey, just call his mama, you know. I'm just he like, you know, I'm supportive, but you know, she better understand it than me. You know, and so there on out, like I had a village, you know. Like y'all always say, it takes a village to raise a child. And I really have had a village, like from my grandparents, aunties, uncles, and my father. Like, my father played a big role in my life. Black fathers, man, I love my black father. Got to. So I take everything that they tell me into truly, deeply consideration. Like, I thank God every day. Like you said, just being in a room with God, just you and him in that quiet room and them four walls. I still, to this day, just think about when it rains, just me looking outside the window of my bed, not being able to move, not being able to eat, walk, talk, being on the feeding tube. I'm going to high school year in a wheelchair. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's hard not being a regular kid. It's hard feel like you being overlooked, left out, can't do ABC, you know? It's hard seeing your mom cry. It's hard not being able to put a finger over it. Everything that my family tell me every day, like, keep your faith, keep your faith. But sometimes you question it when you're still in the same position. And I just have to realize that God was just building my destiny over time.
Yes, he was.
I wanted it now, but he wanted me to be patient. And, you know, back then, I wasn't comfortable telling this story. But now I'm very comfortable. I just had him open my eyes to a lot of great things. You know, I was still sick doing my homework. I was still sick, you know, getting it done. I had to graduate. It was my eighth grade year, I had to graduate. You know, I couldn't look back, I had to graduate. And on to high school, I'm still sick getting these scholarships, doing work. Nothing but God. Nothing but God. I just thank him so much. Yeah. And I thank you all. Like, everybody here is just has a story of their own to tell, and it's very beautiful in their own way. And, you know, it's like, I'm 18, I got a lot more to go. I'm just now getting comfortable to the scenery, and this is what I want to do in the future. Like, I love just being in other people's lives and helping any way I can. Yes. Because that was taken from me. Yes. I wasn't able to do anything. I went from 140 pounds to 90 pounds in 2 days. Wow. Like, man. It was days while, you know, everybody had a day was, why me, why me? But my mom said, why not you? Even though I went through a lot of pain and trauma at that time, I look at it as a blessing.
Come on.
And now I'm kind of happy it happened to me. Now I'm over here happy to tell T.I. Yeah. If it wouldn't happen, I wouldn't be able to tell this story. So I'm blessed to be able to tell this story, and I'm blessed I'm here to tell this story. I just want to thank y'all for giving me y'all time. I appreciate y'all so much, and I just want everybody to know, just keep fighting. Even when I thought it was over with, I thought I was done fighting, I just had to pull through. It was one day where I passed out. My mom had to catch me. I was unresponsive for like 20 minutes. My mom called 911. The line is busy. My grandma had to come around the corner, like she lived around the corner. I was at Riverview. My mom had to reach out to her friend all the way in St. Charles for 911 to pick up the phone to come get me. And I told my mom that day when I finally came to, I ain't remember nothing but having a conversation with three angels. I don't remember nothing but having a conversation with those three angels. And you know, my mom just was one day in the hospital just panicking. You know, as a mother, just panicking. I just told my mom, calm down, working on one of God's projects. And now she see the project in works. Like I say, it's not how you start, it's how you finish. Man. You know, I don't never try to get emotional because I try to be strong. I know it might seem like I'm just mumbling, but I'm just glad, like, I'm just happy to be in this position. Like she said, this award means something to me. After hearing your story, after hearing everybody else's story, it's like I'm with my group of people. It feels good not to be judged or look different. We could talk about something we could relate. Yes. I don't have to be the outcast. You know, I feel like that in high school. You know, high school years, you want to live your best life, have fun, but I wasn't able to do that. I wasn't able to do a lot of things, but I just switched my focus on something positive. When I was in that position, I didn't give up. I continued. Even when I got that position, I didn't decide to go be out here. I decided out here to make a positive impact, not be out here and fall to the statistics. I'm just happy to be here, like I said. Amen. It's just truly a blessing. Thank you.
You have anybody you want to thank?
Oh, yeah, I'd love to thank my mother. My father here too. And I would love to thank all y'all just for the support. Thank y'all.
Granddad.
Oh yeah. Granddad. My auntie Sam too. I truly support. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Hey guys, this touched me because this is why we do it. This is why we do it. Y'all give it up for his parents and his tribe one more time.
Praise God, everybody. He's worthy to be praised. And I just want y'all to say this with me. You probably know the song. It says, soon as I stop worrying. Come on. Worrying how the story ends. I let go and I let God. Let God have his way. Let go. Come on. Let God. Let go. Can you hear the mama? And let God. The son told the mama, let go. And let God. Let go and let God. Soon as I stop worrying how the story ends, I let go and I let God have his way. I too am a recipient of Destiny Over Diagnosed Awardee. And I called myself today, I was gonna try lashes for the first time, and I went to my sister girl and I said, listen, I want the magnetic kind. And she looked at me and she said, Miss Lily, I'm so sorry. I can't even sell you these eyelashes because I know they're going to be on your shirt. So I just want to say God is good. Come on, let's give a hand clap of praise for the ones who just received that award. And it ain't nothing like having somebody in the village with you while you going through the storm. Why you feel as if nobody cares, God sends somebody. And let me tell you something. When I was worried about mine, and I kept saying, Lord, this young man, he dropped some nuggets. He said, now, Darius, let me know if I got the word right. He was dope, y'all. Did I get the word right? All right, he was dope. And all I could think about is this. He said this. If you give up, you won't win. That's for somebody in here today. If you give up, look at your neighbor and tell them, if you give up, you won't win. And any winners in the room? We the winners. Amen. So the next person that I have in store for you today, this young lady is bad to the bone, and I can say it because she's my family. And I didn't even find out, you know how sometimes you can be at the right place at the right time? I was at the right place at the right time and didn't know it and walked in, and I said, oh, this young lady sure is beautiful. And I told her, I said, you know, you ain't got to hate on nobody. You sure are beautiful. She said, well, thank you. And then I said, what's your name? She said, Victoria McCoy. I said, McCoy. Now, that's my family. And we started naming people, and before I knew it, we got on the same row. So I want you to meet Victoria today, the owner of a healthy meal preparation business called Victorious Foods. Victoria is an author, a nutritionist in training, a fitness enthusiast, who is passionate about helping people achieve their health goals through proper nutrition and exercise. She started her business by overcoming her personal struggles with battling an autoimmune disease, lupus, through proper nutrition. She made her mission to make healthy eating convenient and accessible for everyone, offering a variety of nutritious meals options for busy individuals and families. And with her expertise and dedication to healthy living, Victoria has become a trusted name in the local community. Everybody say worldwide.
Worldwide.
You just put it in the atmosphere, right? He says, speak those things as not as though they were. So worldwide, we ain't gonna say local, we're gonna say worldwide. For clean eating and healthy meal preparation. So I want you to give it up for this beautiful bad woman right here. She is not, and she fit, y'all. So if you need somebody to help you out, she is the woman to do that. Hallelujah.
I might make mistakes, but I don't let it break me, cause I'm still on my way. I don't believe I'm something special. Take that from me, so you can say what you want. I go harder, stronger, be who I'm supposed to be. Cause I'm unstoppable, I get all the way in it. That's the way I was made, and I'm up on my business. Cause I'm unstoppable, ain't no
number hoping, one, wishing, before me. Did you ever diet high in processed food?
Much of a speaker, not in public at least. But to start off my story, I got diagnosed with an autoimmune disease called lupus in 2008. I was 19, fresh out of high school. And to be honest, I think I had lupus way before then because I was experiencing a lot of aches and pains at like 14 years old. But when I was diagnosed, they couldn't put a finger on it as well. In a hospital for over a month. They're running tests after tests, everything coming back negative. And they kind of looked at the scope of things. Like, okay, she's a female, she's black. Between the ages of 18 and 35, it's lupus. And I was just like, no, it ain't. You know, I was kind of in denial when it came to something like that. But I was experiencing extreme high fevers, boils all over my body. Those were like the first symptoms. There's a lot of outer rashes. So as I seen my doctors and everything, they was like, you do have lupus. You know, you got to manage it. You got to do this. You got to do that. And I wasn't taking it seriously still. And then years later, I ended up in the hospital again. And at this time, I was about 3 months pregnant with my son. And I was experiencing heart attacks, kidney failure, pleurisy, which is like inflammation between the lungs. And they gave me 6 months to live. And they wanted me to abort my son as well because my body just wasn't strong enough to hold him. So I had two teams working for me at the time. I had the internal medicine team that works for me as an individual. Then I had the OB team, which works for the baby. So those teams did not get along at all. So the IM team was like, we got to save her life. Let's abort the child. And the OB team was like, no, the child is more important. Let's just try to get Victoria body function enough to develop this baby along the way. Even if she passes away, we can keep our body functioning, even though she's brain dead. So I'm having these conversations, and at a very, you know, I was 22 years old, very young age. And at the end of the day, I was like, God, whatever you have for me, you have for me. Like, if this is my time to go and this is my way out, so be it, because that's my story. That's the plan that God has for me. So got through everything. I had blood clots in my lung and everything. It was a lot going on at that time. And I had to do a lot of CAT scans while being pregnant, a lot of procedures, kidney biopsies and all this other stuff while being pregnant. And lo and behold, I went through the whole trimester, third trimester. I ended up giving birth a little early. And we both made it. And thankfully, we both made it. My son was born with neonatal lupus, which is like baby lupus that he grows out of since he has my blood in his body. He has to get old enough to pump his own blood and cycle my blood out. So he is 11 years old now. Stand up, Calvin. My son is such a character. He is 11 years old, and in the midst of all of that, I'm trying to still manage this lupus thing. I'm still having issues, even though I'm out the hospital. I was in quarantine way before COVID was even a thing. And so I still had my issues from time to time. And one day, I think he wasn't even a year old yet. I was at church and my bishop was, you know, preaching and, you know, all his yelling he be doing. And he was like, if anybody up here need healing, you know, come up here. And he does a lot of healing services and I never go up there. I'm just, you know, I'm a preacher's kid too, so I've seen a lot at church. So I'm like, people be falling out, doing the most, you know. But that particular day, I went up there with no hesitation, no reservation. And I just went up there like, thank you, God, in advance for healing my body. Thank you, God, in advance. That's all I kept repeating over and over and over again. And he laid his hands on me, on my chest, because that was, well, his wife, he had his wife lay her hands on my chest. And he put his hands on top. And he was like, what you want God to do for him? I'm like, I'm having heart issues. Like, I couldn't even lay down for over a year because every time I lay down, my heart starts to race. And that was when the heart attacks began. So I was just like, I need, you know, healing or whatever. So laid his hands on me. He was like, is the pain gone? I'm like, no, it ain't gone. You know, so he praying for other people, going, you know, person after person. But he told me to stay there. So he praying. And then I was just like, all right, it's taking a minute. So I'm moseying back to my seat. And he was like, I said, stay right there. So I stayed right there. And I was like, thank you, God, in advance for healing my body. Laid his hands on my chest again. And instantly, it was like somebody put pepper under my nose. I started sneezing. I haven't sneezed in over a year. And I kept getting ammonia and stuff like that because when you don't clear out your lungs, you get pneumonia. Yawning clears out your lungs, sneezing, coughing. I couldn't do any of those things. So when he laid his hands on me, I started sneezing. And I knew right then and there I was healed. And from all of that, I'm like, so from all of that, God gave me very specific instructions. He said, I can do what you can't, but you got to do what you can. And that's when Victorious Foods kind of got its first kickoff. I cut out processed food at the time, and I started just exercising, doing what I can, working out 3 days a week. And I'm like, I'm not going to eat no more processed food. In a matter of 6 months, I lost 50 pounds. I went from 11 different medications. Now I'm only on two. And then through the midst of all of that, my doctor, he was just like, what are you doing? Like, your blood work almost looks normal or whatever. And I was like, well, my God, heal me first. He started going through the office. He was like, what church you go to? It was a Jewish guy. He was like, what church you go to? And I was like, I go to Faith Miracle Temple. You know, it's a Pentecostal church. He was like, I found the cure to lupus. Go to a Pentecostal church. I'm like, he just yelled it through the office. It was so funny. But throughout the midst of all of that, Victorious Foods was born. I was meal prepping for myself, and people were asking, like, what are you doing to stay in shape, da-da-da. And lo and behold, I created a business overnight, literally in like a week. Got my logo, got my website, got my menu, and I made my first order on my son's birthday, February 24, 2019. And I'm a full-time entrepreneur. I wrote a book. I'm traveling, you know, I'm speaking. God is good. So with all that, I say, there's a quote from Seneca. He says, sometimes even to live is an act of courage. So whatever it is that you're going through, just living, keep taking a step at a time. It's going to get better. It will get better. So keep your heads up. And that's my story. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
You deserve it. She been through a lot, y'all. To live is merely courage, right? All right. Before we go to the next one as she's coming up, I just want to give reverence to my real handsome husband, Delancey Brown. Somebody say, Delancey Brown, your wife loves you. It's a lot of sleepless nights going to a vision. It's a lot of not right now. I'm busy. It's a lot of that when you have a vision from God. And I thank God that he heard the vision and didn't say I was crazy. He heard the vision and said, now we have a vision. And I'm forever thankful for that. Thank you, Delancey. Husband, I love you. And we can move on to the next honoree.
All right, everybody. Let's keep everything going. We have heard from some amazing people on tonight. Well, we have another one for you guys. Her name is Miss Angela Monroe. When they told Angela her diagnosis was myasthenia gravis, they be having some names for these diagnoses, y'all. But when she heard that, she was out like, who? Not me. That was her first thought. Why God would allow something to slow her down? But by the grace of God, the illness literally did the opposite. It sped her up. Angela really feels blessed that God allowed her to be a soldier through this illness that she tried, that tried to steal her destiny. It tried to steal her purpose. But can you say, but God? It tried to steal her dreams. It even tried to steal her life. But Angela had to tell myasthenia gravis her name. Her name is Victory. Let's welcome Angela Monet.
God gets all the glory! Woo! So myasthenia gravis, I don't really want to talk about it too much because it don't belong to me. But it is, and I want y'all to understand something too. It seems like every illness that gets up here, it's an autoimmune deficiency. And I want to give charge and expose the enemy that for every synthetic drug, there is a God-given cure and a God-given herb. I just want to, yeah. And I also want to tell the devil, I understood what you saw in me. I understood that you had to give me some crazy name, myasthenia gravis, because you knew I was going to kick your butt every time I got up. You knew it, so you was like, oh, from the womb, I'm going to disrupt her. I'm going to make her feel like she's not enough. So my testimony is I started noticing it when I was 24. And I've always been ambitious. And I start falling down. And I was like, oh, I'm getting ready for a wedding. I'm working two jobs. And I'm going to school. So that's, I'm wearing myself out. Let me rest. And then I just kept falling down. Then I started double vision. This double vision and this weakness. And then I told my fiance then to be, something is wrong. Something is not right with my body. He was like, oh, it's just stress. So I go to the doctor. First they said it was multiple sclerosis. They really didn't understand what was going on with my body. But they did blood work, and they found out that it was myasthenia gravis and that I probably had 10 more years to live. Whoa. So I go back and tell my fiance the diagnosis, and I said, this is your out. We do not have to get married. You know what it's going to do to my body. At that age, I wasn't in my faith like I am now. So I didn't understand to speak against it. So he was like, no, we're going to rock this thing till the wheels fall off. And in the beginning, he did. He tried. So when the diagnosis started taking effect on my body, because when I came down the aisle, I was like this gorgeous Barbie doll with all this hair. Then when the medication came, the hair came out. That's why they said for sickness and in health. The hair came out. My skin got darker. The pain got harder. It got dark for me. It got so dark, I said, because he married me. I said, if you put a pillow over my head, nobody would know. They would just think I had complications. Can you do that for me? Can you just do that for me? If you just, because it was, I was in so much pain every day. So can you do that for me? So then I didn't have anything but God. When he would go to work, because I couldn't wash myself, I couldn't move myself, I couldn't maneuver my body like I wanted to. And I'm so young, and I just wanted him to just go ahead and end it. It is okay. Nobody would know. But while I was alone in the house, while he would go to work, I started to call on him. And by this time, I'm wearing trifocals because my vision has failed completely. So as I was walking down the aisle, I saw two groomsmen. I only had three bridesmaids, but I saw six. So I go back to the doctor. It's getting increasingly worse. So they put me on all these steroids, and I had so much, 10 medications, turned my skin completely dark. And then they said, so you have to have this surgery. And it was called a thymectomy. The thymectomy surgeries was supposed to give me a 50-50 chance of survival. So this surgery, now I've had two children since then. I'd rather have a baby again. Because they take your chest and they cut it open and they take it and they have to open your chest, open like heart surgery, pull your heart out, get the diamonds out. And I had to heal from that. But when I tell you right now, I love my scars. I wore a low cut because my scar, I'm still saved, y'all. I'm still saved. But it's my warrior scar. I love all of my scars. I love all of my flaws. Let me tell you, to any woman that's going through domestic violence or somebody that don't understand emotionally what you need to get through, just pray for them and ask them to get you out. How do you get out? So at this time, my husband, he wanted out, but he didn't know it would be this. To him, he probably thought, this would be dishonorable to leave this girl. So then he was like, but I want kids, so I'm going to try to have you some kids. And I know my body probably won't carry them. But I carried two kids. I carried two kids. And I did it for him. I carried two kids for him. And then the cheating came. And then I said, well, I can't do it, so just let them cheat. Just let them do it. But that was to my self-esteem. Because what's wrong with me? It's the scars. I'm not attractive anymore. It's me. I'm not worthy for you to love me in sickness. So I end up leaving him because God said I was worthy and that my identity was in him. It wasn't in a man. My identity was in Christ. And then he told me, now start calling yourself royalty. That's why I got this on. Start calling yourself royalty. Lord, royalty? He said, yeah. I want you to start saying the solution and not the problem. You don't ever say the suit. And then he said, then I'm going to give you another principle. I want to show you how to be healed. I'm like, what? If y'all want to write this down, this is how you be healed. This is how you be set free. This is how you be delivered. See, it starts with a head faith. Now faith is the things hoped for and the substance of things not seen. You don't see your healing. You don't see it. So it's a head faith. I'm saying something. It's a head faith. And then when you start speaking those things, it be not though they were. Lord, I thank you that my eyes are coming back together. Lord, I thank you that my body is walking in the predestined to you, oh God. I thank you that every vessel, every tissue, everything got to come in alignment with the word of God in the name of Jesus. Every day I spoke that over my life while my husband was cheating. And it broke me. It broke me. But I kept telling myself who I was in God, that I was beautiful, that I was strong, that I was more than a conqueror, that I was who God created me to be, even if he couldn't see. So I ended up leaving him, coming to St. Louis, had to go back and live with my mom. Oh, God. Whew. But my mom did help me, and I thank God for her, through transitioning, trying to figure out, how am I going to raise two kids by myself with this illness? And God said, you're going to do it with me. I'm going to help you through it all. And he's helped me through it all. And I just want to give honor. I didn't tell you everything, all my accolades, because I want God to get the glory. Amen. I want God to get the glory out of my life. And I also want to say, and I'm going to give you the mic back. I also wanted to say that God has helped me in a career that I pour back into children with special needs, that have special needs, autism, and that have disabilities. And I so resonate with them. And I just honor God today. I love you all.
Get up for Angela Monet.
I work too hard for this. Look, I don't look like what I've been through. Amen. When I ain't have outside money, I stayed in. When hard times showed up, I could have caved in. But mama didn't raise a loser, I played a win.
Give it up for Miss Angela Monet, y'all. Her story, my God. I truly understand. This is personal for me because this person has been with and around me for the past 7-8 years and has been faithful over a few things, okay? So I'm just praying that God continues to make him ruler over many. This recipient name is Andre Boyd. Andre is a survivor. He has faced many challenges in his life, including a near-fatal accident, cancer, and pneumonia. But through it all, he has never given up on his dreams. Andre is what they call a jack of all trades and a master at them too, okay? He's a licensed manicurist in my salon, all right? And I mean, come on now, he does it. I ain't gotta help him. Y'all gonna see what I'm talking about. He's a published nail artist, a candle maker, and a baker. He's also a gifted writer and is currently working on his first book. Andre is passionate about helping others. He has partnered with the local adult daycare to provide monthly nail services to their residents. He also is fluent in English and Spanish. And he volunteers to translate for those in need. Andre is an inspiration to us all. He shows us that it is possible to overcome any obstacle, no matter how difficult it may be. He is a survivor, and we are grateful to have him in our lives. I'm grateful, furthermore, to have him in my life because he has truly shown me that you can do all things. I've watched Andre for years. Before I even got him a big boy nail station where the people can sit at the pedicure bowl and put their feet in, all he had was the foot soaker. And I would watch him fill it up, wheel himself over there to his area, do people's feet, take the bowl back, wash it off, and repeat the process over and over. And not once did he ever say, "Fever, can you help me?" I watched people try, and he like, "I don't need y'all." Let's welcome Andre Boyd, a miracle in the making.
Good evening, y'all. Okay, y'all, this is really new for me. But I know I'm amongst family and friends, so I'm going to take authority over these nerves, okay? All right, so I am very grateful to God because I realize that he puts people in my life who can see things in me that I can't see, who are able to recognize the gifts that God put in me that I can't see. And so I want to thank my mother. Mama, you can stand up. Because if it wasn't for this woman right here, when I tell y'all, a single mother that raised her son sacrificed everything she had to make sure I had what I needed. I mean, I can remember times when I was a kid, I had to miss school because she had to work. But she made sure I knew how to cook. She knew how to make sure I knew how to sew my clothes, wash myself, that was important, and just take care of myself while she did what she had to do. She's been my number one cheerleader. She's supported me in everything I've done. She's never told me no unless she had to, unless I needed it. And my little sister sitting beside her, she's been my number one supporter too, so. And I'm going, Fever Daniels, I'm going to brag on her too. Fever, you see things in me, and you're always encouraging me to do things that I never knew, thought I could. And so I thank you for that. This award, guys, kind of validates everything that I've been through. Back in 2002, I was involved in a major car accident that if it wasn't for the rearview mirror, I wouldn't be here right now. I wasn't wearing a seatbelt like I should have been. And when the car lost control, I went flying through the front windshield, broke my neck, shattered my eye, was in a drug-induced coma for 3 days. And this is when I was living in Kansas City. But God. God knew that this was going to happen, so he gave me a job with a company that took care of not only me, they actually flew my mother in to go and be with me from St. Louis to Kansas City. They flew her in and set up like a shuttle service from my boss's house. So they come to her house to see me at the hospital. They took care of her, and I really appreciate that. So the doctor said I would never be able to use my hands. I'm using my hands. The doctor said I'd never walk again, but God said he took up my infirmities and he bore my diseases. God said he was wounded for my transgressions and bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of my peace is upon him, and by his stripes, what? I am healed. My pastor years ago, about 15 years ago, stood up in front of my entire congregation and said, "Andre, the Lord told me to tell you, soon and very soon, you will not need your wheelchair." So I'm determined. It hasn't happened yet, but I know I will walk again. I will walk again. So fast forward to 2018. Thought I was done. I got diagnosed with cancer. I had what was called a retroperitoneal liposarcoma. What that is basically is a cancer that really invades your organs. So it was a 20-pound tumor they took out. Yeah, 20-pound tumor. They said it was so big they had to cut it out in 3 sections. That's how big it was. I had whittled myself down to 115 pounds. That's how much weight I lost. And to this day, I still struggle with my appetite, but it's getting better. But through all that, I'm still here, and I'm not going nowhere. And I was also blessed, people mentioned that I do have a candle company. I was able to start a candle company during the pandemic. And I was sitting at home one day, and God just dropped the name of the business in my spirit. He said, I want you to call your company J. Rapha Candle Company. And if y'all know the names of God, J. Rapha stands for Jehovah Rapha. That means God who heals. And my desire is for everyone who uses my products, whether it be a candle, I also make body products, I make sugar scrubs. Anyone who has who uses my product, I want them to have a personal encounter with God. That's my desire. So like I said, I appreciate you, Miss Sarah, for recognizing something in me. Fever Daniels, I appreciate you. My auntie, I love you. Mother, I love you. And baby sister, I love you too. So thank y'all for this.
That was a beautiful first half. We have a selection from our beautiful orchestra over here. Yeah. And then we'll hear from Poetic Sounds. And then we'll transition into the next set of people. Take this time to dry your face and thank the Lord. Amen.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmony of liberty. Let all rejoice.
Lamont up here, and we're about to get happy, so we might need y'all to clap. We got to get the clap started first, but y'all know how we do.
Hello.
All right, y'all, we're getting keys up here. How many of y'all are having fun so far tonight? That's good. All right. You're ready. One, two, ready, come on.
Come on, clap with us right now, come on. Are you feeling?
Happy.
Tell me, are you feeling?
Happy.
We about to do this cause we're happy,
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 happy. Hey, it might seem crazy what I'm about to say.
Ooh.
Sunshine, she's here, gonna take a break.
Take a break.
Hot air balloon, I could go to space.
We can go to space now.
With the air, like I don't care, baby, by the way. Because I'm
happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. Because I'm clap along if you feel happiness is the truth. Because I'm clap along if you know what happiness is to you.
Because I'm
clap along if you feeling that's what you wanna do.
Happy.
I'm happy. It comes the bad news, talking this and that.
Boom.
Oh, 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 oh.
Boom. Give it all you got and don't hold back.
Oh, 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 oh.
I should probably warn you, I'll just be just fine. No offense
I,
to you, but I, don't waste I, your time. Because I'm
happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof.
Because I'm
clap along if you feeling happiness is the truth.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you know what happiness is to you.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feeling that's what you wanna do.
You know I'm feeling happy, boom. You know I'm feeling fine, boom. You know I'm feeling happy, boom.
Special people. There are a few more special people that we have to acknowledge on tonight. And the first person that we want to do is Dr. Nicole Robinson. Come on, let's give her a hand. Is the founder of Hatch for Hearts Foundation, which she credits to her initial diagnosis of cancer, stage 2 breast cancer. Sorry about that. Her journey began with a simple gesture of providing hope through giving hats and headwear to other patients battling cancer. In 2014, she faced her diagnosis head on and openly admitted her fears of losing her hair as a result of chemotherapy treatment. She thought with losing her hair, she'd also lose her identity as a woman, which led to her advocacy beginning. Her organization provides supportive services to cancer patients undergoing chemotherapy, breast health awareness, and education. The gift of hope specializes an expression of solidarity to cancer patients that they are not in the battle alone. In 2018, Nicole was re-diagnosed with stage 4 of metastatic breast cancer, which shifted her mindset and refueled her focus. That's why she playing I'm a survivor. She shifted her focus towards living beyond her diagnosis. And today, come on, y'all, say today.
Today.
She continues her flight. Nicole is impetus of the word overcomer. She is led by her convictions and compassions to invoke change through advocacy, through efforts through sharing her personal journey. She currently serves as the Vice President of Public Policies for a National Developer and volunteers on multiple boards. She acknowledged finding her purpose as a result of her cancer diagnosis. Who does that? Which she stands on her promises. Repeat after me. If cancer doesn't take a break, oh no, y'all gotta say it like you mean it. If cancer doesn't take a break, neither will I. Dr. Nicole Robinson.
It's been, I have to be honest, I didn't know what to expect for this evening. And just to hear all of the testimonies. I don't usually dig and tell my story really because I have to put myself in this place mentally, right? Yes. With being diagnosed with stage four, so I can't focus that I'm stage four. You know, my cancer has spread to my bone. I just don't focus that, right? So God is my, he's my strength.
Come on, come on.
And so I just don't focus and really tell the story. So it's, when I have an opportunity to, it's tough to dig back, right? And man, so I was initially diagnosed with stage two breast cancer when I was 42. I was living in Los Angeles, thought I had this great life, you know, working for, you know, the federal government, had this great job, and all of a sudden, this diagnosis. I hear often people say, the why me, why not you? And it was my shift, my first shift, I have to say, when I say I found purpose in my diagnosis. Just like everyone talks about, you had a village, I had people coming with me, like to come from St. Louis to go to treatment with me. It was amazing. So that village, it was amazing to have. I have my sister with me. Man, she is my rock. She gets on my nerves though, right? I'm just gonna be real. I was just traveling just the other day, had a dinner meeting. She didn't know all of my schedule, but she didn't hear from me, so she automatically shifted the scripts and was like, okay, where's she at? And my daughter was like, yeah, she probably had some kind of meeting. But my sister, look, let me just tell you, I love you. I don't know what I would do without you. She keeps me grounded. I heard Keisha say earlier, God will sit you down when it's time for you to stop. Because I will just keep going. Because I'm like, God, as long as you give me breath, I'm going to be found doing what you want me to do. No matter what.
Yes.
And so I just, I don't know. It's just God that has me in this space. And I don't understand it. I know my family don't understand it because they'd be like, can you just sit down for a little while? Can you get over one thing before you trying to do something else? And when I was stage two, the first thing I was mentioned in my story, I was afraid of losing my hair. I knew nothing about chemotherapy, knew nothing about treatment, and so that was the main thing I was afraid of, like, your hair gonna fall off? Like, oh, that's a deal breaker. That's a deal breaker. But everybody was like, we're going to shave our heads. Everybody in my family started shaving their heads off and, you know, cutting their hair. And I was all like, I ain't committed yet. I ain't committed. I just cut my hair a little bit. I was like, but everybody was shaving their heads and classmates. And at the time, I was also in graduate school and I was working on my doctorate. And I was like, God, you know, I've come this far in this program. Like, how can I stop? So I would go get treatment, know I would have class. I knew I had about 3 or 4 hours where the treatment medication would start kicking in, when I would start to go downhill. So I would be like, okay, I got 3 hours to sit in class. sit in class for 3 hours. Okay, it's almost time. I gotta hurry up and get home before it kicks in. And it was just,
wow,
so many things. I had chemotherapy. I had the breast surgery. I had a lumpectomy where they removed a portion of your breast. I had radiation, had like 32 rounds of radiation. And the radiation, I didn't know, it was like frying my skin, right? Wow. So I wasn't even able to tolerate the rest of the radiation treatment, but I can just remember my skin was just like peeling off, like, and I was just like, it was so traumatic, you know, not even just to think about all the emotions that you go through and deal with, but it was a traumatic experience. But I'm gonna tell you, God,
yeah.
Shh, I'm gonna tell you.
Yes.
And then here I am. I started this amazing foundation. I started it the first day I had to go to treatment. I went to the chemo room, and if you ever been to a chemotherapy room, it's just one open room. There's no privacy. Every patient is in the room. You're at the different stages. Some people have already lost their hair. Some people's about to lose their hair. But you can hear nurses saying, so are you depressed? What you going through? Or have you taken all your medication? We haven't seen you in a while. I mean, you can just, it's just open. And so I wanted to do something to give back. So I was gifted with the idea by God, of course, to bring some hats to chemo patients. So I was like, told myself, yeah, I'm gonna start this foundation. She was like, you in treatment. I'm gonna start this foundation. It's gonna be called Hats for Hearts. And she was all like, okay. And I'm like, it's the hats for the patient and the patients are the hearts. And she was just like, I'm with you. So what we started doing, we started collecting hats and headwear for chemo patients. We would have a fundraiser and ask people to donate new hats, wigs, and then we would just take those hats and we would donate them, or take them on the floor at Siteman, and we would ask them, can we pass out hats to patients? And it was such an amazing experience just to do something that uplifted somebody else. But it was also my ministry that I didn't even know. Because even though I was giving something to them, it was really just helping me get through my own battle. And then so fast forward, 2018, I was re-diagnosed with stage 4. I'm telling you, I was devastated. I've been having this back pain. You know, I associated, I'm getting older, my back is hurting. A few days, I had been just laid up on the couch. I just couldn't move. I'm still not living at home, so nobody really knows what I'm going through in another state. And so I had gone to urgent care like multiple times, and I'm like, I'm having this pain in my back. And they were like, okay, they gave me muscle relaxers, pain pills, but I was still just laid up. I just couldn't function. I was like, you drinking too much Starbucks? Everything is just your body, you're getting old. And one day I woke up and I had this lump in my neck. And I was like, wow. And it was like really sore. And I was like, wow. So I called my oncologist, because at that point I was on maintenance drugs, you know. I was surviving, I was on maintenance drugs. And I called her and I said, you know, I woke up, I had this weird lump in my neck and it's hurting. So she was like, okay, come on in. And so I was like, oh, okay. So we go in, and then all of those emotions, those initial emotions, when you first, like, what's about to happen? You have to get the biopsy. I can remember getting a biopsy in my neck. And I was there and the nurse was holding my hand and I was thinking like, oh my gosh, is this happening to me again? Like, is this really happening? So they biopsied in my neck. So when the results came back, my cancer, which is called metastatic breast cancer, that means your cancer has spread to other parts of your body. So for some people, it spread to the lungs, the liver, the brain. So for me, mine has spread to the bone. And I was like, you talking about hit, like, everything left. Like, I had this cry that I think I had held in for like the years of the first diagnosis. It was like this deep wailing when it just came out, like I was like, God, like, stage 4, like, when you hear stage 4, you know you dead, okay? I'll just be honest. I'm like, I'm not going to live. I'm like, I was like, God, I'm a good person. Like, why me, God? Man, I just, but look.
All right, y'all gonna make a shout.
You would never know I have stage 4 cancer. You would never know that I'm in treatment. You would never know last year I had spine surgery where they had to inject cement into the bone in my back to reinforce so that God is good. And all in that to say, God is amazing. I'm so grateful to you, my sister. All these wonderful stories, amazing. To my beautiful sister, I love you. You are my all. Thank you, guys.
That one right there almost got me. I have a brother right now that's in stage 4 pancreatic cancer, and each week we get different things. And so even though some of you just came to support someone else, y'all don't know y'all feeling me up to go back and support him. And he even talked to Victoria too, my cousin, so that we can help. But you know what? Now I want to share this one young man with you that I just think the world of him. His name is Darius Thompson. Come on, let's give a round of applause. And while you are singing, he can follow you. He don't need you know how you have to read the music? He can play it for himself. He has an anointing, not only for music, but he has anointing for teaching. He is able to be able to hear the music, and within a matter of seconds, he can be able to play the melody that you have in your spirit and in your heart. All he had to do was just, while they were singing, he could have walked right up here and just continued to play with them. And listen, this is the other thing that I love about him. The anointing not only on him, he's allowed it to fall on his children. I watched this young man while his wife was going through sickness, and while he was helping her to go through it, he was also being strengthened in the Lord. I mean, whenever his wife was going through, he could have said, you know what, I ain't gonna make it to rehearsal today. I'm not, because he used to play for us. I'm not gonna be able to make it to church today. Let me tell you something. This is a warrior. Hey, he's a warrior. And you know where his warfare is? In worship. Hallelujah. So, and not only does he play, but he has anointing for singing as well. I got you. You bless me. You don't know. You changed my life. You changed my life. You were young, but guess what? I be watching. I be peeping them young people, because you just never know. You hear me over there? You never know when the anointing might just fall on your robe. And since I met you, since you start playing for me and said, no, you can do it. You got it. Come on. From that, I said, you know what? He told me I can. And so when somebody tell you you can, you got to have that choo-choo attitude, right? What you say, I think I can, I think I can. And after a while, you start saying, oh, no, I know I can. Come on. So y'all give it up for this mighty man of God.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord again. So many familiar faces in the room. I thank God for being here on today. I thank God for this opportunity. God bless you, sis, Sister Sarah. God bless you. It started for me. I'm healed. I'm delivered. I've been set free. It started for me from the time of 2013 until about 2023. I have 5 minutes, so I'm going to be very, very short, quick, and effective. 2013, I was diagnosed with aplastic anemia in the month of June. I'm going to be skipping some things. I was told I wouldn't be able to have children. I had to learn how to walk all over again. I couldn't take care of myself. I lost 60 pounds, 65 pounds in 1 week. I was put on Ensure through a tube. I had the chemo burns, as you can see. I had two catheters, one to go on my left side, one to go on my right side. I had a brother who was a 10 for 10 match, and I thank God for him, Jonathan Thompson. If we can give a hand clap of praise for him. He's not here, but he was my 10 for 10 match. Had he not been, I would have died of graft versus host disease. But God did not see fit for that to be. I have 4 children, one on the way, with my wife. In 2018, I buried my first wife. She was sat there with me through my treatments. She never left my side. She wouldn't eat. I have witnesses in the room, my Aunt Key, my mother, Pastor Frank's his wife, Pastor Lily, God bless you, love you all. They are my witnesses to what I had to face. I would take my son with me. My wife was in the my wife was in emergency surgery. My twins were in the NICU, Desani and Deshaun. I had my son, my oldest, my toddler at the time. I would take him to church with me, and I would give him snacks, and he would sit right beside me as I played during service. So I would go from service to hospital, from rehearsal to hospital. I couldn't work a job, but God blessed me in my hands to make the financial needs that needed to be met. I almost died 3 times. Lord have mercy, Jesus. He's been so good. I want to dance, but I don't need music, y'all. But I thank God for what he's doing. I buried my wife. As I told you, I was homeless after she passed away due to an unforeseen situation concerning a family member. They had access to the livelihood of me and my children. They handed me my stuff and laughed in my face. I became homeless, but I forgave. I have a family of 6 going on 7. I have a house, 2-car garage. Forgiveness is access to your breakthrough of your healing. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, God can deliver you from the trauma of what you were meant to go through, so you can walk into the glory that God has bestowed upon you. And so, Lord, I want to just run. I'm sitting out here listening to everybody. My God. Hiya, my Shanda. Heshetebe. Heshanda, my Masa. Heshetekebeya, Saya. Heshanda, the Mosa. Yes, God. Is there a worship and a praise in this house? My God, today, when I tell you, when I saw them put the dirt on my wife's casket, ...25 years old, she was there for me. I was there for her. I had to nurse 3 children in one room and take care of a wife that was dying in the next room. mentally, the place it was putting me in. But somebody say restoration. This is my wife right here in the red. It's so much to say, but I do have a little bit of time. And I will go to what God has just done for me. I went home one day. It was a Wednesday in the church that I go to now, to my pastors that wanted to be here, but they couldn't be here. Pastor James and Pastor Jacinta, I love you. Tabernacle Church of St. Louis, that's our church, that's our ministry. And a woman who came and prayed for me, she asked for my wife's permission to lay hands. She laid hands on me. And when my wife died, I had to go see a doctor, a specialist, and then one of the top in the country. When she died, I ended up having a stress fracture in my hip. Doctors that they gave me medicine prior in 2013, it come back up in 2014. I couldn't walk for a whole year. My whole left side was stricken. And 2019, my right side began to diminish in strength. Now, mind you, I'm homeless, still taking care of three children. So I'm picking them up. We moved in with my godmother in the city off of Richard Place. I'm taking them up four flights of stairs. I have two pumpkin seats in my arms, a toddler on my shoulder. That's what I had to do. And I never left my children. I'm a real father. I wasn't sleeping around after my wife died. God kept me. And so I went to go see the specialist after my primary care said, I'm going to send you to one of my colleagues. He said, he looked at me, he said, your x-rays, he said, they are unique. I said, what makes you use those words? He said that you had a stress fracture, but now it's developed into something else, a vascular necrosis. And I've been working, playing, carrying equipment, taking care of a family, nurturing the whole family with this bone disease for all this time. Because of malpractice. Tell your neighbor, malpractice, God can reverse. And I thank God for my wife for sending in that video to Sister Sarah, because that's the reason why I'm standing up here today. I was in service, scratch that. I was at home. I took a spiritual bath, and this is what a spiritual bath is. And I'm gonna tell you what a spiritual bath does. Because the spirits can't get in you, they try to attack you. So you have to pray over the water that you're running. You have to take oil that has been fasted over and take three drops, one for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the sure enough Holy Ghost. And I did that. The Lord took me into a vision. Have you ever thrown a rock into water and it seen the rings? The Lord showed me that in the sky. He said, tell my people to ask for what they need because the heavens are open. That was on Wednesday. I'm summing it up. This is the reason why I'm here. How I got here, if I should say. I'm summing it up. So the Lord told me then, I said, okay, God. I said, there's something that I need. I want total healing in my body. And I tell you, that Saturday, I went to a women's meeting at the church. Two brothers of mine were playing. They asked about me, is Darius coming? Because I play at my church. And I said, Lord, I got my kids together. Darius, Desani, Deshaun, and Noah. I said, okay, we're going to church, y'all. Did not even know that I was going to receive a healing in my body. Instantly. Instantaneous supernatural. And so, as the sister, she said, brother, come here. She said, get your wife. May I pray for your husband? She prayed for me. Instantly, I was healed. The Bible say, according to your faith, be it unto you. And this is, so it's some people in this room, and Lord, I'm not trying to go here, but you may have not had a physical, but your spirit. Somebody say spirit wounds. It's some people that have been dealing with spirit wounds in this room. But that's why God has brought you here today, to hear about the physical that God has done in people's lives, so you can believe him for the spiritual that you need. I'm done. But I thank God for Jesus. Because if it had not been for him, on our side, we would not be here. God bless you, and I love you.
My God, my God, my God. He is worthy. He is amazing. I mean, he can do all things but fail. I just want to stop real quick and just say thank you, Lord, for everything you've done, everything you're doing, and everything you're about to do. Isn't he good? Isn't he worthy of the praise? Give it up today. Tangela is a master level social worker with 16 years of experience working and volunteering in various social service settings. Upon completion of her bachelor's degree in social work in 2005 from the University of Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri, UMSL, Ms. Bolden became a child abuse and neglect investigator for the state of Missouri in St. Charles County. Following her work in the state, for the state, Ms. Bolden earned her master's degree in social work in December 2010 from UMSL. She went on to receive her master's in Christian ministry with a focus on biblical counseling in 2018. From Missouri Baptist. Ms. Bolden currently holds a position for the board of American Cross Charles Drew Blood Drive since 2012 to this present day. She sponsors two Charles Drew Blood Drive each year at Vashon High School, She launched the Vashon High School Food Pantry in 2008 with the help of several dedicated community partners. The pantry relaunched as Wolverine Market in 2021, sponsored by the St. Louis Area Food Bank and Fresh Time Market. Ms. Bolden believes the situation we are faced with on a day-to-day basis serves to build our characters. She feels that these experiences teach us how to accept a hand up and empower us against handouts. Let's welcome Ms. Bolden, everybody.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Good evening. I heard some very familiar things as I sat and I just listened. Thank you, God. I was diagnosed with sickle cell anemia at 18 months old. I was born 3 pounds. and a little early, a little bit. And pause. Can I have my village stand up? Because I thank God that even though we grow up and we become adults, we still have our village. Please. I thank God for each of them. My mother, that has been, you talk about a rock. I don't have a word to define the strength that it took to sit and watch and hold my hand and answer the questions that I asked. My pastor, which I thank God that's an answered prayer, to have a church home, a covering, it's an answered prayer. My sisters, this is my blood sister, birth sister, we shared the womb, and my prayer sister. Another baby sister, I'm going to say. And I just thank God for them in my life. I thank God for my village is humongous, and I thank God for it. So at birth, 3 pounds, warrior, fighter, all of that was there. My mom said that they would come in and tell her how I was too small for them to fasten a diaper on me, so they would just lay me on it. And when they would lay me on it, I didn't like to be wet. So I would lift my little bitty frail body from what they could see, and I would scoot off the diaper because I didn't want to be on the wet part. And as I've gotten older, I would hear her tell me some of those stories, and they provide me with so much strength to stand in this journey. It's lifelong. It has appeared to be never ending. But I thank God for strength. I thank God for courage. I thank God for destiny and purpose and call on my life being created for such a time as this. I feel like this our season, y'all. Like it's our time to reach back and lift up those that feel like they want to tap out. Because I know what it feels like to want to tap out. I know how it feels to be down and hurting and in pain to where you can't get up on your own. To have a bedside commode because you can't get up and walk to the bathroom. To have to use when they put the little pot, the little thing in the bedpan. Like it can be humiliating. But God. And then God. That's what I've been taught. And to go from this diagnosis and to continue living, to keep living day by day, pressing toward the mark. I don't always get it right. But grace and mercy. The avascular necrosis diagnosis, I have that as well. I had a total left hip replacement. But y'all see, I got heels on today. You see these heels? And I was about to take them off. Because I was like, I got these heels on. But God. So when you hear that we don't look like what we've been through, if somebody had their way, I'd have been out of here at 18. I give God glory for 44. To be 45. Like, those things blow my mind, and it is awesome, and it is amazing, and it is not me. It is purely God's grace and his mercy and his loving kindness toward me, toward us. To be able to work a regular job. To be able to be a servant leader. I thank God for the award and the acknowledgement because it is beautiful. I'm okay with being in the background and you don't call my name and you don't know my face and you don't know none of that. I'm okay with that. But God said, no, ma'am. you don't get to hide out back there, because that little light I placed in you is going to shine for the world to see. So anytime that I'm given the opportunity, I'm going to always give God the glory. The avascular necrosis, the hip replacement was 2013. And they found it in my left hip, my right hip, both my shoulders, and both of my knees, all at the same time. We are here at 2023. And I've only had the one hip replacement. I was told I couldn't have children. On that picture, you saw me with my son. If I was gone at 18, I would have never had the opportunity to meet him. There are many seasons that we go through in our lives. Health is just one of them. There are many other challenges that we face that we go through. And I know I had an experience. So when we had the flood last summer, I lost my home, I lost my car. But I thank God he saved my life. He saved my grandson's life. I have guardianship of my grandbaby, which live with me. And I'm like, he saved our lives, and we were able to walk away from that. I had a month-long sickle cell crisis after that. God said, go sit down. I didn't have to go to the hospital, though. I just had to go sit down. You know, be at home, sit down, chill out. And then went back to work. I love my babies ever shine. I'm a full-service schools coordinator there. And I love serving them and loving on them and being there. They're like, Miss Bolden, why are you here? You hurting. Baby, ain't you here? And you're looking at me. So I got to be here, because if I wasn't here, who would you be looking at right now? Went through that, was able to, God blessed me with another home. And the home came to me. The home tracked me down and found me. And a brand new vehicle. I purchased a 2023 Kia Sportage X-Line. It was like a spaceship on the inside. I was like, yeah. And then in March, I was in a car accident. I was rear-ended and my truck was totaled. And I remember feeling like it was too heavy. And I remember I reached out to my pastor, and I was like, I'm over it. I'm tired. I'm over it. He was like, what does that mean? You know, I'm like, just over it. Like, it's getting on my nerve. It's one thing, then it's another thing, then it's something else. And the one thing that I've learned in this journey is we don't get to tap out. You don't get to say I'm done. You don't get to say I'm tired of it. You don't get to say. And he reminded me ever so gently that God has blessed you to come out of everything that you've gone through, and you come out stronger. And I just had a whole flight fiasco just the other day, yesterday. And I remember I was sitting there trying so hard not to cry just because I was feeling heavy. When the enemy knows that you've recognized and you've accepted the call on your life and that you've chosen to say yes, that you will say yes no matter how bad it hurts, no matter when it hurts, no matter what time it hurts, no matter what it is, my yes still stands as yes. My yes will always be yes. Even when I deal with the health stuff that a lot of people don't understand, that when you talk about it, they don't get it. They look at you like, oh, well, maybe you should go on disability. No, that ain't that's not what God said. He healed me so I could be doing something to show somebody else. You can't see the light shine from my house. So I can't sit in there with that. So I choose to get up. every day and continue to press toward the mark.
God bless you.
All right, guys, we're coming up on the last award of the night. We're going to hear a little selection from Poetic Sounds, but I want to let you guys know that this last award is the award we're here for. This is the award we're here for. Everybody else is destined for greatness. Everybody else has destiny over diagnosis, but we want to shine light on the person that is getting ready to go through their journey. The person that don't know what they have ahead of them. And that is our award of the night. But first, we'll have a selection from these wonderful people one more again, and then we'll have the final award of the night. Give it up for Poetic Sounds.
You know what? I'm so thankful to be among so many miracles tonight. Yes. You know? And we got a song called Thank You that we're going to share with you. Ready? One, two, three. I was young and didn't have nowhere to run. I needed to wake up and see what's in front of me. There's to be a better way. Say it again, a better way to show I'm grateful. So I thought of this song. Ooh. To show my appreciation for loving me so long. Ooh. You don't know how much you mean to me. Cause even though my times got rough, you never turned away, you're right there. And I thank you, when I felt had enough, you never turned away, you were right there. And I thank you, thank you. All through my life I knew that you'd be my world. Knowing everywhere I'd go, things you taught me they would show. So many times and changes you see me through. I sure enough couldn't have survived without you, without you. So then I thought of this song to show my appreciation for loving me so long. Oh, you don't know how much you mean to me. Cause even though when times got rough, even though you were right there, yeah, I thank you, when I felt had enough, you never turned away, you were right there, and I thank you, oh, when even though when times got rough, you never turned away, God, you were there for me, had enough, you never turned away, you were right there, and I thank you, come on, da 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 da. For all you've done. Cause even though when times got rough, you never turned away. You never turned away.
And I thank you.
When I needed you,
when I felt
I reached out, God, and you touched me. Oh,
thank you.
Cause even though when times got rough, you never turned away.
I thank you
when
I felt I had enough. You never turned away, you were right there. And I thank you, oh, da-da, da-da, oh, God, Lord. Da-da.
Give it up for Poetic Sounds, guys. They are a beautiful a cappella group. Like, they get down, they travel around. We're blessed to have their presence. Thank you, Poetic Sounds. I want to give a quick thank you to my mother who is in the building. I don't see her. She birthed me out, y'all. I thank her, and I want to give a shout out to my grandmother who's in the building. 84 years young. I thank you. My spiritual parents, Lily and Michael Franks, I thank you. And the DOD doers, the Destiny doers, I thank you. This could not be possible without the volunteers. This cannot be possible. So I want to present this last award, and then I want to give some more thanks, and I want us to eat. Okay? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah to the hallelujah. We got great food. I'm sorry about the length of things, but God has had his way. So I wanted to present this award because it is near and dear to my heart. This is the Destiny Bound Award. The Destiny Bound selection simply tells the person that despite what the doctor may have just said, despite what your medicine cabinet looks like, despite how much pain is in your body, you are bound for destiny. You are bound for destiny. And this is why we're here. This is why we do this. It's not just to tell people that there's destiny over diagnosis, but we gotta reach back to the people that have no clue. That have no earthly clue that they still have a destiny. Yes, amen. And so I want to play the video, and then I want to talk about this wonderful young man.
Formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work, for I know God will do what he said he would do. He will stand by his word. He will come through, for I know God will do what he said he would do. He's gonna stand by his word, yeah. He will come through. So no weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon formed against me shall prosper.
That video touches me because I know this boy. I know that struggle. I was witness to his first seizure in episodes. And I remember crying out to God. I said, no, he doesn't deserve this. I've experienced that before. But that boy came out of that episode and said, God is good. He went on to say, Jehovah Rapha, I need you. He's already decided that his destiny screams way louder than any diagnosis at 12 and 13 years old. This young man had to stop going to school.
His social life was interrupted, but he still proclaimed that the joy of the Lord is his strength. He also had the courage to talk to people and ask him, TT, when you have a seizure, what you feel like? And what's this? He didn't keep it to himself. He was wise enough. I didn't say smart. I didn't say smart. That's ABCs. I said he was wise enough to reach out to his village. And I'm telling you, me and this boy, we have such a bond. I love his mother. That is my sister in the Lord. But when she went through with her son, she stopped almost everything. She's the operator of Heal Her Ministries. And she was about to stop Heal Her Ministries to heal him. She wanted to focus on just him, but her village came together. And we did what we had to do. But I just wanted to say to you both, that it is an honor. It is an honor to recognize you guys as the recipient of this year's 2022. Get on your feet. This year's 2023 Destiny Bound Award to Mr. Jamai Jefferson. Hallelujah. Boy, number 13, y'all, he's been through something.
My name is Jamai Jefferson. I'm 13 years old, and my testimony is that for some months, I was having these seizure-like activities. So, I'm sorry, this is kind of hard to talk about, but I was having these seizure-like activities to where, like, the doctor couldn't even explain what it was. It wasn't really anybody who, like, could explain. It wasn't really anybody who could explain what I was going through, but I'm just so thankful for the people, like, in my circle. If I didn't have those people, I'd probably still be having episodes and seizures, man. Like, I just want to thank my mom and my dad. Like, without them two people, I wouldn't be inspired to push through. And I also want to give out to my shout out to my grandfather, Timothy Jefferson. May you rest in peace. I remember every time I would go in the living room, he'll just be reading his Bible. And he'd be like, Jamai, they said every time, they said, read your Bible. But ever since he said that, I always read my Bible. And because he said those words, I never stopped having faith in God. So the fact that I had faith in God, that's how I got through the episodes, them seizures. Like, them seizures, they took a toll on my life. Like, I wasn't able to do a lot of things. I wasn't able to go to school. I wasn't able to play basketball. Shoot. I wasn't able to do a lot of things that I love, but that didn't stop me from doing it. that didn't stop me from pursuing my dreams. I told my dad one day. He was like, Jim, what do you want to be like when you grow up? I told him, first of all, I want to preach the word of God. And then I want to be an NBA player too. So, I remember this one time I had an episode, and then I broke my arm. I'm doing physical therapy right now, but it was real bad. So I couldn't move my arm at all. I couldn't even fully rotate it. Like, I was having wrist of, like, a little piece coming out or something. It was fractured. So I couldn't really do nothing that I really love. Hence, I couldn't really do basketball, you know what I'm saying? All my basketball players gave me, I know we got some here at KP. I know you want them. But, I thank my mom for the fact that, like, I learned the things about God. Jehovah Rapha, my healer, he healed me from the episodes and the seizures. She told me this one time, I was young, and she said everything happens for a reason. So I knew God wouldn't, like, just leave me in the dark like that. I knew the episodes ain't happen for a reason. I didn't give up hope that, like, I wouldn't get healed. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, like, I never gave up hope. I always prayed, listened to my worship music, did my first 15, five minutes of worship, reading the Bible, and praying. Yeah. The last thing I want to say is everybody be yourself, like, cause especially in the generation I'm in right now, like, a little bit hard to be yourself. sometimes you get talked about, but you got pushed through it a lot of times. You know what I'm saying? Like a kid like big old kid like me, wear a size 14 shoe. You gotta keep your ground. You know what I'm saying? Like you gotta get some tough skin. But it's always good to have that circle around you, cause at my dad's church, Faith Church, we got this thing called Rev. It's like where all the teenagers go, like, talk to each other. I got friends over there. They accept me for who I am. Even my, like, my cousins. Shoot, got some here. I got a lot of people around my circle that have, like, inspired me to do things, and that, like, push me to be the best person I can. And I thank God. I thank God for that. And I pray that I become the man he made me to be.
God exceeded my expectations and what I prayed for, y'all. I have two scriptures in it, and I'm ready to eat too. Acts 2:44-47. It says, all the believers were together. This is where the first church got started. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to one another, and those that had need. 46, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to the number daily. The second scripture is 1 Peter 4, verses 8 through 11. It says, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. 11, if anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength of God that he provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. I brought up those two scriptures because if it had not been for my village, the first church got started in small, intimate sessions. And they brought every gift that they had, and they met each other's needs. And so my village, they brought their gifts to my home. They brought their gifts to my living room. They scrubbed my floor. They washed my dishes. They brought me food. One night, my sister Kiana in the back, and I'm giving a shout out to my village that's in here, and my mom and my brother, she said, what you want to eat? The Lord told me to take you out. I said, I don't feel like being in the public. I don't want to see people. I'm irritated. And she said, well, God told me to get you out the house. And because I respect and know my friends, I hear God when they speak. I said, I'm going to get on out the house. She said, what you want? I said, well, I want Red Lobster biscuits, but I want Cheesecake Factory too. The girl showed up at my door with Red Lobster biscuits and said, let's go to Cheesecake Factory. It takes a village. That's the encouragement I have for you. Y'all ready to eat?
Amen. 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 Let me get this picture with her, him. Amen. Give him some hand, guys. Give him a round of applause. He earned it. He earned it. He earned it. Just some quick housekeeping, then we're going to bless the food and pray out. If Kiana James can make her way to the front. This event would not be possible without volunteers. Let me say that. So I want to say thank you to every volunteer, every destiny doer that came and did. I thank you. Even the space that we're sitting in right now is donated. Everything that you see, the core, Laura and her mother, Sister Regina, everybody donated their gifts, just like my sister just said, brought their gifts. And I want to thank everybody. I want to thank the host, Lady Lily and Fiva. I want to thank all of you guys. I want to thank my three children, Trinity, Charlia, and Kayvon, my husband, my sister Rocky, Rachel, sorry, for putting those videos. Was amazing. She did all those videos, y'all. Like on a whim. On a whim, my sister Taff, she flew from Minnesota for the day to be with me. If I had prayed for this, I would have shorted myself. But I want to shine a light on Kiana James right here. Kiana produced this entire event. She put her blood, her sweat, and her tears. Please give it up for her. She heard my vision, and she believed it, and she said, we have a vision. Every ticket, every place a balloon is at, everywhere a chair is at, every cone, everything was orchestrated by this woman. Last year, I did this entire thing by myself. And the Lord said, I'm sending you wind. And sometimes you gotta make sure you receive the wind. You can reject wind, y'all. You can turn your back on wind, but I did not. And I thank you. I just wanted to publicly thank you for every sleepless night in my indecisive ways. This is like planning a wedding. I thank you. I thank you. And I love you. I love you. This is what friendship looks like. This is what sisterhood looks like. All of this, everybody, all the team. I can't even begin to list them all because we'll be here too long. But I thank everybody, every single person. And lastly, I just want to say, because everything is donated, I do want to open the opportunity to sow a seed into this place. Sow a seed into this place. Even the caterer, she donated her time and the food. Yeah, this is donated. Everything you see is by God's blessing and donation. Sister Kim, she prepares a delicious meal for us. Ursula not here. She decorated the tables. I mean, every single thing is because they heard God's heart. And they said they wanted to execute this thing in the earth because it was already done in heaven. So this is an opportunity to sow a seed into this organization. We would love to keep doing it off of favor. But it does take green money to make things move, to keep our 501c3, to get to the nations, to get those scholarships that we want to give to people. I mean, we ain't able to get $4 million yet, you know, Mr. Griffin over there, but we want to do that. And it starts here. So if you have something you want to donate, you can see
who's doing that. Melissa, right there, she'll come up. And then we also have a Cash App. Where is my sister? I believe it's Destiny Over Diagnosis. Okay, thank you. Who said it? Thank you. So it's $DestinyOverDiagnosis. So you can look at your program, you can look at whatever. It's $DestinyOverDiagnosis, and anything you give will be a blessing. Because we want to do this again next year. Last year, we was in a community center. This year, we in this big, beautiful church that was donated. Shout out to First Love. If you don't have a church home, make your way over here. They love everybody. They love everybody. So they donated all this. They air, they space. Shout out to Eric. That's the pastor's son. Eric seen the vision, and he grabbed hold of it. I appreciate you, brother. So, yes, that's how we'll be able to get that done. $DestinyOverDiagnosis. If I missed anyone, please don't charge it to my heart. It's my head and my belly. I'm hungry. So, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for today. We thank you for every testimony, every inspirational moment. Lord, my prayer is that somebody got something out of this. I pray that people were fueled today. Even as they poured out and fueled others, they found fuel for themselves. And Lord, I pray that they take that fuel and they'll take it to the nations. They'll deal hope everywhere they go. Lord, I thank you right now for covering this place and covering everybody in their respective places. Rapha, Jehovah Rapha, thank you for being so sweet to us. Thank you for letting us have this place. Thank you for being able to talk about our healing, talk about our deliverance, and walk in our freedom. Thank you, Jehovah Rapha. Thank you, Jehovah Rapha. Thank you. So, Lord, bless the food and continue to bless everybody and let it be a blessing to them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.